Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Continuous State of War, Empire Building and Race Making in the Civil War Era Gulf South by Maria Angela Diaz. Narrated by Angela Juarez. Introduction. Wanting a Southern Empire. In 1853, Frederick Law Olmsted, then primarily known for his travel writing, traveled to Texas. Long before he became one of the nation's most famous landscape architects, Frederick and his brother, John Hull Olmsted, crossed the Red River on horseback into the state. For months, they lived in the saddle, making note of the vast landscape through which they passed, and encountering the state's various inhabitants, including white slaveholders, working class and poor whites, enslaved African Americans, wealthy, and working class Mexican Texans. As they wound their way through Texas's cotton lands, Olmsted observed that whenever slavery in Texas has been carried in a wholesale way into the neighborhood of Mexicans, it has been found necessary to treat them, Mexicans, as outlaws, and forbidden, on pain of no less punishment than instant death, to return to the vicinity of the plantations. Olmsted's observations hinted not only at the contest over territory between Anglo-Americans and Mexicans, but also at the racist views of white enslavers who were suspicious of Mexican Texans. It also reflected the way such views were applied to a variety of peoples of color in the Gulf South region throughout the mid-19th century. Olmsted's experiences in Texas revealed the contestation over slavery's expansion that would draw the communities of the Gulf South into the tumult of the American Civil War. Throughout the Civil War era, the Gulf South was in a continuous state of conflict. War existed in the far-flung borders of the Gulf of Mexico and affected communities large and small throughout the entire southern coastal region. From the 1840s to the 1880s, white Southerners in the Gulf South fought with Native Americans, Mexicans, Cubans, the Spanish, and finally, when Americans went to war with each other, white Northerners and free and enslaved African Americans. These conflicts placed the Gulf of Mexico at the center of Southern expansionism and were an important part of expansionists' efforts to construct a race-based imperialist fantasy that justified and perpetuated territorial conquest in Latin America. Coastal print culture engaged in a regional and national production of ideas of empire, race, and manifest destiny, while coastal communities hoped to benefit from this hunger for more territory. This collection of ideas and efforts framed the Gulf of Mexico and Latin America as an essential part of Southern expansion. A Continuous State of War examines the central role of Gulf South communities in Southerners' attempts to grab territory in Mexico and the Caribbean, and the effects that this process had on those communities. I argue that Gulf Coast communities facilitated both the physical efforts to seize territory and the construction of the highly racialized imperialist ideas that imagined Latin America as a region that could secure the South's future. Yet the pursuit of that territory created a fluctuating and uncertain situation that shaped the choices of the diverse peoples who lived along the upper rim of the Gulf of Mexico. White Southern concepts of race became more rigidly fixed through the wars chronicled here. The fantasies of expansion were not snuffed out at the Civil War's end, but persisted in the attempts of former Confederates to resettle in Latin America in the post-war period. By studying expansionist wars and the ideas used to promote them, this book traces the ways that ideas about Latin America and its peoples took shape within the complex port communities of the Gulf Coast, as well as within the nation at large. Throughout its early history, the United States obtained, through war and negotiation, different parts of the upper rim of the Gulf Coast. American control over the region continued to be contested, even as it served as a launching pad for further expansionist projects. Indeed, the wars of expansionism that occurred around the Gulf of Mexico during the mid-19th century were as much about achieving authority over the region as they were about using those communities as staging grounds for conquest elsewhere. The United States may have laid claim to Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana by 1820, but conflict still raged across these states and then continued into Texas in the 1840s. This unending conflict and the militarization of the region continued right into 1861, when the Confederate States of America attempted to exert their own control over the Gulf South. Many different worlds collided in the Gulf of Mexico. The history of expansion in the United States is usually presented as the story of westward movement. However, from the perspective of those living in the Gulf Coast, expansion happened west and south. Placing different parts of the Gulf Coast in conversation with one another draws attention to the fact that the whole Gulf of Mexico was affected by the various conflicts of the mid-19th century. Expansionists such as John Quitman, Sam Houston, and Albert Sidney Johnston also saw the borderlands of the U.S. South, Mexico, and the Caribbean as a connected whole. The Gulf South evolved into a center for trade and cultural and political exchange between the Atlantic world, the Caribbean, the U.S.-Mexico borderlands, and the U.S. South. It was also buffeted by a multitude of local, regional, national, and transnational forces. Gulf communities, large and small, continually angled for more military protection, more of the share of trade in cotton and enslaved African Americans, more access to better shipping methods, to the agricultural hinterlands, and more input into the visions that drove expansion. The way that white Southerners constructed ideas about expansion was drawn from some of the most fundamental and far-reaching aspects of Southern society, namely race and slavery. To that end, the inclusion of Texas broadens this study for two main reasons. First, Texas was one of the main sites of expansion in the antebellum period. Second, many of the ideas about race that concerned Latin American peoples were, in part, formulated through the colonization, settlement, and annexation of Texas. For white Southerners, the annexation of Texas, and later the U.S.-Mexican War, served as prime examples of what territorial expansion could accomplish in terms of economic prosperity and the protection and spread of slavery. As this book reveals, examining expansion's effects on different parts of the Gulf South simultaneously makes plain that, despite the tendency in American history to separate the stories of violent conquest against Mexicans and other Latin Americans and Native Americans from that of antebellum slavery, these stories are deeply connected. White Southerners dreamed of them as connected, not only to each other, but to what lay even further south. They dreamed of these spaces and the peoples that inhabited them as coming under their mastery. They feared these connections as much as they fantasized about them. They feared that the failure to extend white American authority would let loose the fulfillment of other fears, such as slave rebellions, and upend the carefully constructed world around them. Territorial expansion was ultimately about the future. Americans were interested in these territories not just because they could obtain more physical land, but because they were enamored with the potential of that land. That is what expansion was all about. Potential. Potential could be either positive or negative, and expansionists saw both kinds of potential in the land they coveted. I have chosen to focus primarily on American expansionist efforts in Mexico and Cuba. The combination of efforts in Mexico and Cuba shed light on how Southern slave society's black-white racial binary was used to shape the racism of Southern imperialism and territorial expansion, and vice versa. Within this vision, Mexico, with its mixed-race population, would be conquered. Meanwhile, Cuba, with its slaveholding Cuban elite, could be annexed as a new state. although Cuba's population was just as complex as Mexico's, the presence of slavery within that society meant that it was often viewed by white Southerners as similar to their own. Thus, while Latin American societies were far more complex than the Southern imaginary depicted, this vision helped to justify the mode of territorial expansion in the Gulf, giving meaning to Southern imperialism and later giving rise to the methods Southerners used to pursue the Civil War in this region. Eventually, these early imaginings formed the basis for how the United States would engage with Latin American countries and Latin American peoples. Figures such as rough-hewn Texan soldiers, Indian fighters, the Great Volunteer Army of the U.S.-Mexican War, a protective navy, and rebellious filibusters all peopled the discourse of antebellum Southern expansionism as the slave state's heroes. In doing so, they fought against a variety of enemies, most of them peoples of color. They went to war with Native Americans, such as the Comanche, the Creek, and the Seminole, Mexicans, the Spanish colonial authority, Cubans, all the while exerting their brutal authority over enslaved and free African Americans. And they were thwarted by many of these foes in a variety of ways that undermined the efficacy of white Southern violence. Where I felt I could, I have inserted the voices and stories of those who pushed back against Southern imperialism. Where I could, I have inserted the voices of the oppressed, the overlooked, the displaced, and the disrupted, who were forced to do the work of expansion, or were forced to get out of its way. In many ways, this is a book about failure. It is about the failure of Southern imperialism, and the failure of white Southerners' attempts to steer American expansion southward into Latin America. Southern imperialism started out successfully, but ultimately hit the disaster of the filibuster craze that began a decline that evolved all the way through the Civil War and finally ended during Reconstruction. This book brings into sharp relief white Southerners' frustration with the fact that their lived realities often failed to measure up to the fantasies they created. It is also about the failure of the Confederacy to salvage those fantasies once it became evident that the United States federal government and army no longer cared to prop them up. During and after the Civil War, the national project of expansion persisted and grew into the imperialism of the late 19th century. But it did so without Southern fantasies of a slave power dominant in the hemisphere. Even objections to a slave empire that stretched into Latin America, however, were based in racist notions regarding the peoples that lived there. Whether it was an empire based in free labor or slave labor, it was still an empire determined to take things from people of color and give them to white Americans. The work found here speaks to the transnational turn in Civil War era and Southern studies. The work of historians to place the American South in a broader context and in conversation with other nations and spaces provides a lens through which to understand the Gulf South during the 19th century. A significant part of this historiography concerns the study of the efforts of Southern slaveholders in the United States to create for themselves a transnational empire based on slave labor and cotton production. Southern historians continue to make important connections and comparisons between the slave societies of the U.S. South and Latin American nations and colonies. This book builds on this important work by addressing the manner in which the region's imperialist inclination shaped how Southern whites related to and understood Latin American people as a race. Justifications of slavery not only racialized African American people, they were also part of how and why white Americans constructed racist images of Latin American people. Therefore, if there was any kind of kinship to be had between the slaveholding South and the slaveholding societies of Latin America, the relationship was never perceived as equal. Southern whites did not necessarily seek unification between these worlds. Rather, they fought for control and dominance over those they viewed as racially questionable or altogether inferior. Furthermore, the drive for empire and racial supremacy was also motivated by the fear of being eclipsed within the nation, as well as on the world stage. Historians studying the creators of Southern imperialism often cast them as self-confident men, and it was especially men, leading the nation's expansion with a cosmopolitan outlook on the world and a singular vision. However, a study of both the words of Southern imperialists and the ways that the ideas they promoted played out on the ground demonstrates that they were as much reactionary as they were visionary. They articulated nightmares as much as they did dreams, and the Civil War was born of both. Studying how white Southerners interacted with and conceived of Latin American societies in the mid-19th century uncovers as much about Southern society as it does about their conception of others. As the decades passed from the 30s to the 50s and challenges to slavery mounted, they defined themselves as against the outside world as much as they did against the North. Southerners criticized the classed societies of Europe, as well as those to be found in Latin American nations, especially Mexico. In so doing, white Southern critics revealed much, not only about their constructions and understanding of race, but also their understanding of class. In recent years, work in transnational history has demonstrated that debates concerning secession were not only about battles to determine the fate of the nation, they also concerned the goals of the United States in terms of its position in the hemisphere. This book is a reminder that the Civil War, in part, answered these questions of empire. Much work that has been done on the transnational connections of the Civil War focuses either on the level of the wealthy planter class or that of government officials and diplomats. The U.S. federal government laid out a plan for westward settlement and colonization even as its armies marched on southern locales and men died by the hundreds of thousands. Historians have understood these policies as efforts on the part of politicians in the Republican Party to gain during the war what they failed to attain in the antebellum years. These policies also reflected a decision concerning the process of expansion that veered away from more Southern attitudes toward empire. Centering Gulf South communities gives us a window into how local communities dealt with these same connections throughout this period in U.S. history. Borderlands history and its unique perspective proves essential for understanding the Gulf South in the 19th century. The Gulf South is usually treated as a borderland during its colonial period, when French, Spanish, and English colonial authorities tried to exert their power over the region, oftentimes against Native American nations and enslaved African Americans. As Samuel Chouette and Pekka Hamalainen noted in their essay On Borderlands, this perspective speaks to the promise and the challenges of exploring non-traditional borderlands, such as bodies of water. Viewing this mid-19th century Gulf South through a borderlands lens highlights the complex and often interwoven nature of cultures, races, and violence in these communities. It also highlights the fact that, though a large swath of the Gulf South had come under U.S. authority during the first half of the 19th century, that authority was still heavily contested and fragile. Additionally, examining the manner in which members of these communities helped to construct racism as it pertained to Latin American peoples demonstrates that it was not just Anglos in the Southwest who were doing this work. It occurred in multiple spaces along the borders of the United States simultaneously as the nation pushed west and south. The Civil War, though seemingly outside of this story, must be situated within it. Even with the transnational interventions, it is often still largely understood as a different kind of war than those that came before or after it in the 19th century. Examining the experiences of communities in the Gulf South helps to put the pieces together. While the war was a fight over the fate of slavery and the nation, it was also about the way that the nation would expand in the West, as well as its imperialist interests in Latin America. Recentering the region puts these complex aspects of the war's central narrative in focus. We see the way that the South's imperialism split from the larger story of American expansion by examining how these communities were shaped by both sets of ideas. A continuous state of war begins with the Texas Republic just after its establishment as an independent nation in 1836, and examines the different sides of the annexation debate within Texas. It explores the way that violent conflicts in the Texas Republic shaped ideas about statehood, independence, and race. The process of annexation stalled before President John Tyler's administration, and this encouraged those in Texas who sought independence. Annexationists concocted a powerful story of an imperiled Texas engaged in fighting off Mexicans and Native Americans that galvanized support for their side and helped bolster the eventual outcome of statehood. Chapter 2 examines Pensacola and West Florida and that territory's parallels with the violent tensions that existed in Texas. It explores the ways that Pensacolians used a similar discourse to advocate for improvements made to coastal defenses in West Florida, amid the continued resistance to Indian removal, the Second Seminole War, a Creek Rebellion, and the outbreak of the Mexican War. Chapter 3 focuses entirely on the U.S.-Mexican War and traces several key aspects of the discourse associated with that conflict. At the end of the chapter, the words of soldiers and sailors are used to understand how expansionism shaped their experiences. What comes out of an examination of the war is an image of Mexico and Mexicans as a people who required violent control, both in the United States and Mexico. These ideas, both about race and class, would be used in the filibustering craze that took over after the war and is discussed in Chapter 4. The U.S.-Mexican War was followed by a rash of filibuster expeditions and increased efforts to obtain further Latin American territory. This chapter addresses the Narciso López expeditions to achieve Cuban annexation and focuses on New Orleans as a point of connection between the Caribbean and the Gulf Coast communities. After serving as the major jumping-off point for thousands of soldiers headed for Mexico, New Orleans became a hotbed for filibustering and a growing Cuban exile community. An analysis of the ideas used to justify the filibusters reveals that white Southerners' imagining of Cuban society was framed against the backdrop of both the U.S.-Mexican War and Southerners' past relationship with white and black Creoles in the Gulf South. The failure of both Cuban expeditions as well as the failed attempt to negotiate with Spain over Cuba reveals chinks in the armor of Southern expansionism. As white Southerners in New Orleans pushed for Cuban annexation, city boosters in communities along the Texas coast, especially in Galveston, the city's largest port city, sought to encourage the influx of settlers into the Texas hinterlands. Accordingly, Chapter 5 revisits the area covered in Chapter 1 on the eve of the Civil War. It examines the rising tensions between Anglos and Mexicans in the years following the U.S.-Mexican War and suggests that the war actually settled very little for Texans. This chapter also covers the way that city officials in Galveston proceeded to make their city an important site of trade, both of slaves and cotton, and immigration for Texas. Chapter 6 examines the outbreak of the Civil War and its effects on the Gulf Coast. Southern interests in Latin America evolved with the creation of the Confederacy. Though most secessionist discourse focused on the North, the Republican Party, and the threat Lincoln posed to slavery, the imagery of Latin American nations and peoples that expansionists cultivated was also deployed to articulate the hopes and anxieties connected to secession and the Confederacy. Secessionists used ideas about the African slave trade in Cuba and bandits in Mexico to emphasize the necessity of separation. When the war began, coastal communities, especially Mobile, served as important sites of blockade running to the Caribbean to retrieve supplies in an effort to sustain the infant Confederacy. The final chapter explores the transformation of connections between the Gulf South and Latin American nations. After the fall of New Orleans to Union hands in 1862, the Gulf South became a center for white refugees, both Confederate and Unionist, as well as to refugeed enslaved African Americans. In the aftermath of the Civil War, many Southerners fled to Latin American countries, such as Brazil, Cuba, and Mexico. In a dramatic end of a long period of expansionist fantasies, Confederates did not arrive as leaders, but as refugees, desperate to escape a failed South. Ideas about Latin America again changed during the debate that ensued over the movement of ex-Confederates to these nations. In examining these ideas, Chapter 7 links the efforts of colonies of Southerners with developments in the South during Reconstruction. But even here, they could not escape the forces of emancipation. In the end, Southern imperialism died in the spaces that Southern whites thought would sustain it in perpetuity. Chapter 1. The Possibilities of Texas. In June 1844, the New Orleans Daily Picayune published a satirical letter by a fictional character invented by the humorist C.M. Hale, named Pardon Jones. Jones declared, "I'm for annexation, only conditionally. If Texas wants to come to us, and I know she does, we'd ought to take her. If Texas would strengthen the South, and I know she would, she'd strengthen the Union, and we'd ought to have her. If England wants to abolish the niggers in Texas, and I know she does, then she wants to abolish them in the South, and to abolish our glorious Union. As to Santa Annie and Mexico," he added, "we can't wait 100 years for them to whip Texas, and you know as well as I do that they can't do it nohow." Jones's letter touched on several different elements that summed up expansion in the 1840s. It reflected the complex geopolitical contest over Texan annexation and recalled the string of conflicts that existed between the Republic of Texas and Mexico in 1830s and 1840s. As a slaveholding republic, Texas stood between the United States, another slaveholding republic, and Mexico, an anti-slavery republic far larger than the United States. References to Antonio López de Santa Anna, Santa Annie, recalled the Texas Revolution in 1836, in which Anglos and Mexicans in Texas gained their independence. They also touched on the continued tensions between those two groups of Texans. Mentions of Britain as an abolitionist country signaled its continued presence in the Gulf of Mexico and in Latin American politics, and the danger it posed to the United States and the Southern slaveholding states in particular. Indeed, Jones's conflating the interests of the nation and the interests of the South recalled the history of U.S. expansion into the lower South along the Gulf Coast that preceded the fight for Texas annexation. In the antebellum era, the fight for Texas statehood linked between this older history of expansion and the newer efforts at gaining more territory, both for the slaveholding states and the larger United States. For Texans, the road toward annexation was full of uncertainty and violence. From the end of the Texas Revolution in 1836 to the annexation of Texas by the United States in 1845, the Texas Republic navigated a series of geopolitical conflicts, while also being embroiled in the debate over annexation and independence. Annexation was the culmination of a dream, but it was also insurance against the threat of a world increasingly at odds with Southern chattel slavery. Leaders such as Samuel Houston aimed through statehood to protect Texas from what they viewed as economic and political disaster, while others, such as Mirabeau Bonaparte Lamar, favored independence as the best method of protection and prosperity. Public discourse in Texas and Southern communities along the Gulf Coast fixated on events such as the invasion of Texas by Comanche warriors, known as the Great Raid in 1840, and the Mexican invasion of 1842. Events like these were used to demonstrate why Texas annexation was important to American sovereignty and the security of Texas's interior and coastal parts. Understanding the reaction of those living in the Gulf ports, as well as those in the Texas interior, provides a much fuller picture of what was at stake for both Texans and Anglos living in the U.S. South. Texas annexation often is explained as an act of westward expansion, but it was also, as this chapter demonstrates, about securing the Gulf of Mexico under American control. With a coastline that spanned over 300 miles, the Republic of Texas stood at an important geographical location. By 1840, Great Britain's interest in Texas and Mexico gave pro-slavery annexationists in the United States a new sense of urgency when it came to securing U.S. authority within the Gulf of Mexico. Texas was a fertile territory ripe for southern cotton and the growing sugar industry, and was important both for its ports and its lands. The machinations of British abolitionists endangered its great promise, as did an unstable and vulnerable Mexico. The way that annexationists and independence-minded expansionists framed Texas's situation depended as much on the production of racialized fantasies concerning Mexicans and Native Americans as it did on the Republic's geopolitical position. When a coalition of Anglos and Tejanos won the Texas Revolution, the Republic they created altered the geopolitical landscape of North America in a way that heightened the anxieties of slave-owning whites in the South and their kin in Texas. The annexation of Texas marked a transition from earlier American expansionism and what was to come in the Civil War era. Annexation took place within hardening partisan and sectional lines in the United States and in Texas that influenced the ways that Anglo-Texans and white Southerners spoke and thought about the events leading up to statehood. There was a tension between ideas about expansion and the lived realities of Texans during the period between independence and annexation. Though the story of annexation is often depicted as a triumphant aspect of American expansionism and Southern imperialism, in reality, the joint resolution that finally brought Texas into the United States was a last-ditch effort that barely succeeded. Anglo-Texans emphasized their superiority as a fact, peppering their discourse with racist notions of Tejanos, African Americans, and Native Americans, all while constantly having to fight their supposed inferiors. As Anglo-Texans battled against both these various forms of resistance and foreign nations, they used the debate concerning annexation as a way to maintain their enthusiasm for American, Southern, and Texan interests. From the perspective of white Southerners who supported annexation, an independent and ultimately vulnerable Texas was cause for alarm. Anglo-Texans who supported annexation tended to do so because of the reasons often cited by individuals such as Robert J. Walker, the pro-annexationist senator from Mississippi. The expansion of slavery had been at the heart of Anglo-American settlement in Texas throughout the early 1830s, and protecting it created an array of concerns for white Texans and slaveholders in the American South once it became independent in 1836. For the Gulf South, other troubles might plague them if Texas was left on her own, such as added competition for a developing export and import trade. The region also risked losing out on the growing cotton trade in Texas. Over the course of the early 19th century, an intimate relationship developed between Gulf Coast communities of the United States and those living in Coahuila y Texas. During the Texas Revolution in 1836, merchants, bankers, politicians, and slaveholders used those established connections to involve themselves in the war, many with an eye toward eventually annexing Texas, and Texas's political leaders sought aid in the cities of the Gulf South. In addition to the connections of Gulf ports, many Texan leaders held up Texas as a kind of southern promised land, with the power to banish white Southerners' worries concerning land, the growing population of enslaved people, and the financial calamities that had befallen them during the 1830s. Pro-annexationist Texans were certainly obliged to fulfill that image. They promoted their republic as a space populated by intensely militaristic white people, ferocious fighters, which proved to be popular among white Southerners in the United States. To promote annexation, Anglo-Texans also encouraged evolving racist ideas about Mexicans and Mexico that already existed among Americans. Early depictions of Mexicans as being duplicitous and lacking in the capabilities necessary to govern the expanse of Texas was rooted in both the Texas Revolution and the following years of Anglo settlement. These images worked to enhance the idea of Anglo rule and the rightness of a society based in slavery. As a result, white Texans and Southerners outside of Texas began painting much stronger lines of division between themselves and Mexicans than they had during the years before the Texas Revolution. When Texas became a state, it helped set the stage for years of interactions between white Southerners and Latin American people that echoed those initial fantasies and fears. Those fears, in turn, themselves echoed the early 19th century history of the Gulf South, in which Anglos clashed with Europeans and Native Americans in the states that became the Deep South. In addition to American expansion into Spanish-controlled West Florida at the beginning of the 19th century, the annexation of Texas provides a bridge that joins two forms of Americans' expansionism. The earlier expansion in which white Southerners migrated into the lower South, and the subsequent expansion in which white Americans began edging into Mexican territory. What comes after a revolution? Frederick Leclerc, a French physician, arrived in Texas in 1838. He remained for only a few months, but the country made such an impression on him that he felt the need to write Texas and Its Revolution. Part history and part travelogue, Leclerc's book portrayed Southern fears concerning the growing population of slaves and the need to obtain new territory as the main impetus for settlement and annexation. Texas, he wrote, offered an almost limitless field to slave labor, one practically boundless both in area and in the types of agriculture. Florida, Louisiana, and Alabama had been described similarly as places where surplus slaves could be sold and surplus whites could move. Leclerc traveled into eastern Texas, the center of the Republic's plantation agriculture. He marveled at the experience of floating down the San Jacinto River, and thought about the final battle of the Texas Revolution that had been fought there. He characterized the appeal of the region as lying in the natural resources of the country, the beauty of its climate, the possibility of establishing steamboat navigation on its rivers. Texas held out the possibility of abundance, as had other frontiers before it, and Anglos hoped to capitalize on that allure. Attracting sufficient numbers of settlers to the Republic of Texas was actually an inherited problem. Like the Spanish and the Mexicans before them, they now had to figure out how to bring Texas under their control. As Anglo and Mexican Texans fought for independence from Mexico in 1836, the question of annexation to the United States was already a part of the discussion about Texas's future. Over the course of early 19th century, Anglo and Mexican relations had changed significantly as more Anglos moved into Texas and Mexicans increasingly found themselves outnumbered. Yet through the 1820s and into the 1830s, Mexicans continued to maintain their hold on political and economic power, while popular beliefs about the different cultures in the region began to develop. Anglos often drew a distinction between the Tejano elite and the Tejanos who made up the bulk of Tejano society, often emphasizing the Tejano elite's Spanishness and whiteness, while emphasizing the mixed-race backgrounds of other Tejanos. Wealthy Tejanos at times worked as power brokers and cultural intermediaries for the white Americans moving into their country. Mexicans also maintained their own class and racial distinctions within their society, which Anglos sought to take advantage of as they competed for land and political power. Many of the racist ideas about Mexicans were accelerated by the Texas Revolution and the way it was understood by those within and outside of the young republic. When newer settlers who followed the earlier waves saw Mexicans, they thought of the Mexican army and Antonio López de Santa Anna. Indeed, Anglo-Texans who fought alongside their Mexican counterparts during the war had begun to conflate the Mexican army and Santa Anna with Mexican people living in Texas, turning them all, in effect, into criminals. Despite popular support, Texas annexation efforts suffered from bad timing. Within the United States, annexationists met with a tepid reception from President Martin Van Buren and opposition from the growing anti-slavery movement in the United States. These forces understood that the prospect of bringing yet another territory into the United States that was bound to be a slave state might stir up more of the animosity between the free and slave states, undermining the Missouri Compromise of 1820. On July 6, 1837, the acting Secretary of State sought to present Memucan Hunt, one of Texas's first ministers to the United States, along with William Wharton, to President Van Buren. Hunt's mission was to get the United States to annex Texas. However, Van Buren refused to meet with him. Hunt then sent a letter on the issue of annexation to the Secretary of State, John Forsyth. In the letter, Hunt recounted the Texan uprising as well as the creation of the Republic. He compared Texas's history with that of Mexico, emphasizing the Mexican instability that reached its zenith with Antonio López de Santa Anna. Through his conduct in the war with Texas, Santa Anna came to represent much that was wrong with Mexico in the minds of white Texans like Hunt. The minister described Santa Anna's presidency as a reign of misrule and career of blood, and noted that in 1837 he remained at his hacienda, Mango de Clavo, the tiger in his lair, ready to go forth seeking whom he may devour. In the story that Hunt sought to tell of Texas and its readiness for annexation, he emphasized white Americans' role in the settlement of Texas. According to Hunt, until the settlement of Stephen F. Austin's first colony in 1821, Texas, for the most part, was an unexplored wilderness. As had happened with other frontiers that came before it, those imagining Texas conceived of it as a place waiting for white Americans. Hunt claimed that, up to the year 1821, Texian civilization was only to be found within the narrow precincts of their respective jurisdictions. Memucan Hunt positioned Texas as the key to American dominance of the Gulf of Mexico. At the same time, Hunt felt the need to justify the exodus from the United States to Texas. True, in emigrating to Texas, the enterprising colonist had expatriated himself, Hunt wrote, and foregone the well-tried institutions of his motherland. But the institutions he now lived under were modeled upon those he had reluctantly abandoned. Hunt emphasized the shared Anglo-American blood that white Texans and white Americans shared, noting that Texas gallant sons were born upon your soils, and they ask if the single star of Texas is not worthy to be added to the brilliant cluster on their mother flag. To further encourage support for annexation, Hunt spoke about the various advantages in trade and industry that Texas statehood would bring to the United States. Texas provided an additional market for manufactured goods, and Hunt touted the vast live oak forests of the interior, also celebrated by Texan President Sam Houston, and the potential for contributing to the production of U.S. cotton and sugarcane. In contrast, an independent Texas posed a possible threat to the United States due to its vulnerability as a new nation and the ways it would complicate the geopolitical landscape of North America. In 1837, the United States was one of several military and economic powers in the Gulf of Mexico. Great Britain still had a considerable amount of naval power in the Caribbean and Gulf, as well as economic power in terms of its increased involvement in the economies of Latin American countries. Similarly, France also sought to gain a foothold in Latin America. In Mexico, diplomatic relations were intensely strained by 1837 due to what the French saw as unfair trading practices, mistreatment of its citizens, and taxation of French imports. At the same time, Spain continued to hold colonial authority over Puerto Rico and Cuba, two major sites of sugar production. According to Hunt, such threats and political tensions with these rival powers could be easily mitigated through Texas annexation. He argued that Texas is not disposed to yield to any foreign nation the privileges of her coast, involving the command of the Gulf of Mexico, nor can she concede them to the United States unless in a treaty of union. Hunt also drew on what others, such as the second president of the Texas Republic, Mirabeau B. Lamar, would later argue, that Texas had the potential to be a formidable nation on its own. Hunt insisted that the United States and Texas were so similar that they would eventually come to blows, hinting that, in the event of Texas remaining in the attitude of an independent power, there will arise, from the very strict resemblance of the people and the institutions of the two countries, many questions of conflicting interest, the adjustment of which will be most difficult and painful. Pro-annexationists fixated on economic competition and the specter of war. In the coming years, anti-annexationists would use the same ideas to encourage the notion of independence by stating that Texas had the ability to maintain itself politically, economically, and militarily without being included in the United States. Memican Hunt also hoped to put to rest any fears that Mexico would interfere in the negotiations over statehood, stressing the fact that the Republic of Texas's independence was recognized by several other nations, which would help prevent Mexico from intervening. The first country to recognize Texas's independence was, of course, Van Buren's own, the United States. Yet, in 1836, the United States was neither able nor willing to confront the possibility of war with Mexico over Texas. While the United States was several decades older than Mexico, it could hardly afford the international headache that came with an independent Texas. Yet President Andrew Jackson's eventual recognition opened the door to the possibility of further recognition from Britain and France. Hunt assured Secretary of State John Forsyth that Texas has no expectation of an invasion, much less a reconquest at the hands of Mexico. With the onset of centralism under Santa Anna, many states within Mexico rebelled and attempted to separate themselves from the new government that sought to restrict the rights of the Mexican states. Texas was only one of these. All the smoke and mirrors and the self-confident, bombastic rhetoric lauding Anglo-American civilization and its effects on the Texas wilderness belied a very different reality for Texas. Mexico still refused to recognize the treaties that Santa Anna signed when he was captured after the Battle of San Jacinto. In 1837, Texas was a risk. But was it a risk that the Van Buren administration was willing to take? The answer to this was no. The U.S. president's response to Hunt's report cited the main reason as the fact that the United States were foremost in acknowledging the independence of Mexico, and have uniformly desired and endeavored to cultivate relations of friendship with that power. While the possibility of war with Mexico led Van Buren to formally reject the idea of Texas annexation, the controversy over the expansion and continued growth of slavery also contributed to the president's caution. When the United States rejected Hunt's proposal, Houston withdrew the request for annexation. The reality that Texans faced after the failed 1837 negotiations was a struggle to achieve either annexation or independence, amid the fact that the Republic of Texas was as fragile a nation-state as Mexico. While the Republic was not racked with the same level of government instability as its southern neighbor, it was plagued with mounting debt, conflict with Native American nations far more powerful than itself, and the looming possibility of foreign intervention or invasion. Texan fears, fantasies, and vulnerabilities. The main topic at the center of all these mounting issues in Texas revolved around slavery. Anglo-Texans need to protect the institution, which had quickly taken root prior to the Texas Revolution, remained the driving factor in much of the imagery surrounding annexation, and the efforts to achieve it. All the problems that Texas experienced between its independence and annexation continued to unfold when Matilda Houston and her husband arrived in the Gulf of Mexico in December 1842 intent on exploring various parts of the Gulf of Mexico and the Caribbean. While traveling from Texas to Havana, Matilda Houston observed that the central topic of discussion among her fellow travelers was slavery in Texas, and that this question concerned Galvestonians most of all, as their city was one of the main sites of sale and importation of enslaved persons. Houston recalled that Galvestonians had been so indignant over the presence of abolitionists in their town that they banished them from the city. The person in question, she remembered, of one such abolitionist, was conveyed in a boat to the mainland and there turned adrift to preach to the inhabitants of the woods and prairies. Unfortunately, Houston was silent as to what happened to an African-American abolitionist who attempted to speak publicly about ending slavery. But more than likely, he faced worse than the white abolitionist exiled to the woods and prairies. The Telegraph and Texas Register bemoaned the growth of the abolitionist movement in the United States and commiserated with slaveholders in their sister republic, all the while declaring that Texas was immune from its effects. The paper went on to claim that this supposed immunity operates as the most powerful motive on the part of many to oppose the annexation of this country to the United States. The author fantasized that Texas might then become a haven for Southern slaveholders from the mounting opposition to slavery that was developing in the Northern states. Thus, anti-annexationists could use this anger and fear of the infiltration of abolitionists and increased sectional tensions to justify remaining an independent republic. Houston's travels through Texas also coincided with Galveston's efforts to restrict the movement of free and enslaved African Americans. The failure of the first try at annexation, the continuation of Texan independence, and fears of the anti-slavery movement gaining ground in the 1830s and 1840s in the United States pushed Texas communities to continue efforts to regulate both free and enslaved African Americans. The Republic of Texas's Constitution ensured Anglos' right to own slaves, as well as the right of immigrants to import more into the country. By 1840, the Texas legislature passed an act that forbade free African Americans from living in Texas. When notice of the act was published in the Galveston Civilian and Gazette, Galveston city officials attempted to establish further control over the free African Americans still living in the city. The mayor of Galveston declared that the town's African-American population would now live under a strict 9 p.m. curfew. Anti-annexationists gained a significant supporter when Mirabeau Lamar captured the Texas presidency in 1838. He attempted to steer the young nation away from the plans of the annexationists like Sam Houston, whose ideas about Texas were tied to the expansion of the United States. In his inaugural address, Lamar made it plain that his vision for Texas's expansion had little to do with that of the United States. "I have never been able myself to perceive the policy of the desired connection, or discover in it any advantage, either civil, political, or commercial, which could possibly result to Texas." He went on to state that, "However strong be my attachment to the parent land, the land of my adoption must claim my highest allegiance and affection. Her glory and happiness must be my paramount consideration, and I cannot allow myself to speak in any other language than the language of freedom and frankness on all matters involving her safety, dignity, and honor." Lamar took all the arguments that annexationists made for statehood and turned them on their heads. If Texas was annexed, it risked losing its most important rights, such as the right of making either war or peace, the right of controlling the Indian tribes within her borders, the right of appropriating her public domain to purposes of education and internal improvements, of levying her own taxes, regulating her own commerce, and forming her own alliances and treaties. In this nightmare scenario, Texas would be reduced to an unfelt fraction of a giant power, or peradventure divide into territorial districts, with governors and judges and excise men appointed from abroad to administer laws which she had no adequate voice in enacting. Lamar told his fellow Texans that Texas was the cornucopia of the world. With annexation, she would pour her abundant treasures into the lap of another people, who are known to be opposed to her peculiar and essential interests. Lamar's vision for an independent Texas was one that stretched all the way to the Pacific Ocean, encompassing lucrative trade networks in New Mexico and the lands in California. Lamar's interest in expansion to support independence had a dramatic effect on both the size of the military and relations with native peoples and Tejanos. Lamar, along with his Secretary of War, Albert Sidney Johnston, first targeted the Cherokee living in the eastern part of the Republic. The initial band of Cherokee had arrived in Texas decades before the Trail of Tears, migrating into what was then Spanish-controlled territory in 1806. Their numbers steadily grew as others moved in from places like Arkansas, until there were roughly 400 living in eastern Texas by 1830. Other Native American nations, such as the Delaware, Shawnee, and Kickapoo, also migrated to colonial Texas. Though some Cherokee insisted that the Spanish had granted them land, the Mexican government denied this claim. The Cherokee continued to attempt to obtain a land grant even as Anglos began to push into their territory. Sam Houston negotiated a peace treaty with some of the Cherokee. However, at the urging of then-Vice President Lamar, the Texas Senate refused to ratify it and later proceeded to nullify the treaty entirely. Subsequently, the Texas Land Office proceeded to issue grants to the lands that the Cherokee claimed, but they did not have access to buying that land. The influx of white settlers increased pressure on the Cherokee to relinquish their claims. For Lamar, the threat of disloyal Mexicans and Native American challenges to the Anglo settlement could be intertwined. Indeed, for Anglos, any perceived threat inevitably became entangled with their struggle to dominate and dispel Native peoples. In 1839, Lamar wrote a letter to Cherokee leader Chief Bull, accusing the band of Cherokee under his leadership of being involved in the Cordova Rebellion, a Tejano uprising that occurred in 1838, and of attempting to take part in another insurrection. Though some Cherokee warriors had joined the Cordova Rebellion, the majority had not and did not know that other Mexicans were attempting another rebellion. Referring to those Tejanos involved in these uprisings, he wrote, "You and your people have held repeated correspondence with our enemies, have received and cherished their emissaries among you, and have entered into belligerent compacts with them, and have given countenance to an insurrection raised in your own vicinity by Mexicans who have incorporated into our national family and were enjoying all of the benefits and privileges of citizenship." Lamar went on to warn the Cherokee.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.